Thank you for the great Gospel of Luke, and we just praise you that you have given us such insight and walk with you in the power of God. And so, Father, as we are doing and walking through chapter 9 and chapter 10 of Luke, this is power evangelism. And these are the disciples that we're called to be. So bless this word to our hearts, Lord. May it continue to change and transform and lift us up from glory to glory. Glory to Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. All God's people said,
Amen.
Okay, now, if you're going to understand the rest of these texts, we've been looking at a lot in chapter 9, the Spirit and the power of God, right? Now, when you go all the way back to the beginning of Luke, do you remember the beginning of Luke? The Christmas story? What name was there? Did you miss it? John the Baptist coming in the Spirit and the power of Elijah. Now the spirit of Elijah is the ability to stand by yourself in the midst of all the opposition you possibly can face and glorify God. How many think you can handle that one? What do you do when everything is against you, everyone's against you, and you stand trusting in Christ? How many here have that kind of spirit and the power of Elijah? Do you all have that kind of spirit? Amen. Do you have that power?
Yes.
Are you living? No, you can't try. This is not try. This is you do it. Trying is so feeble, sister. Stop trying and do it. Amen.
Amen.
Say, sister, just do it.
Sister, just do it.
All right. Very good. So now we're going to see over and over again. We're going to see Elijah being mentioned, and because Jesus is called the new what?
Elijah.
Now, we just had the Transfiguration, and some of you have been up to that, if that be the one. There are two possible spots. The church says since the 4th century, it's the spirit of Mount Tabor. But you got to know the background of Mount Tabor. Do you know the background? And you went to Israel?
Yeah.
The background of Tabor is the woman Deborah. And where did she do the fighting? Mount Tabor. So where's the power going to be of resurrecting Mount Tabor? Are you getting all this yet? So we come to the spirit and the power of Mount Tabor. Amen? If it be there, it could be also on Mount Hermon, where Jesus said to Peter, "You are rock, and on this rock I'll build my church." Matthew 16:16 and following. So we don't know whether it's Mount Hermon, or we don't know it's Mount Tabor. But from Catholic Christianity standpoint, you're going to have nobody argue with you. It's Mount Tabor. When you deal with some super, super high-level Protestants, they might say, you probably will never hear it. I've never heard them say it. Mount Hermon. So that's why Protestant groups, when they go there, they never take their group to Mount Tabor. What a shame. Wasn't that a nice spot? Even biblically, with Deborah and everything else, the name Deborah means be. So now Jesus comes down. And what do they have in their heart to keep them going? They have the vision. Hosea 4:6. And what's the vision? The vision is this, of what God's calling you to do. If you don't have a vision beyond your nose, you're going to be very disappointed. You got to have a vision into eternity. Amen? Do I hear amen?
Amen.
Are you still okay, Team Jesus? You still fine? All right, Team Jesus is good. Now on the next day, look at verse 37. 9:37. On the next day. Now circle the word next day. What does it mean on the next day? What does this sound like? Creation. When we go all the way back in the beginning of Luke, it's called the next day, on the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me. By the way, if you count up all the things on Christmas, of your true love giving you those things, it now costs, in 2018, $37,000. So, I mean, that's a nice hunk of change, isn't it? If you want all those things added up, just that's for your information. If you want to talk to somebody over coffee and, you know, coffee with real milk and your half of apple pie, whatever the heck you're getting. On the next day, when they had come down from the mountain, a great crowd. Now, do crowds follow Jesus?
No.
The only time for a great crowd is where? At Marty's favorite restaurant. That's the only spot you're going to get. That's the only spot you're going to get. Crowds never follow God. Never. How many ever tried to get your family together to follow God? You're still working on it, right? See, you all should have been what? Dentist. And pull those teeth, amen? So what do we have here? Great mega. Verse number 38. And behold, a man from the crowd said, "Teacher, I beg you to look upon my son, for he is my only child." Does that sound familiar? Somebody go, Now, remember we're in the Elijah cycle. The church has to do something. Every year proclaim the Elijah cycle. Did you know that? So if anybody that goes to daily mass, you have to hear about Elijah every year. And this weekend we'll hear about Elijah again. You have to hear about Elijah. Because so powerful was he in our midst. Yes? So now, what did Elijah do? He raised what? Somebody from the dead, an only son. The woman's son. Remember, he had a big headache and then he died and then he went upon him and he breathed. He did mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. Here it is again. But now Jesus is the what? The new Elijah. "Teacher, I beg you to look upon my son, for he is my only son. And behold, the spirit seizes him." Now, this is the spirit of demonic activity. You see, there are a lot of spirits plaguing you. You had a spirit on you, sir. The spirit of infirmity. All I did was cast it off of you, that's all. But the average person here, you don't know how to cast off your spirits on you. There's a spirit of infirmity. Everybody say that with me. Spirit of infirmity. How many spirits are there? There's 12. There's 12 spirits plaguing you. So what do you do in your ignorance? You just say, "I need to go to a doctor to help me." I'm not saying don't go to the doctor, but in the spiritual realm, you don't know what's bothering you. A, you're going to say, "Nobody told me." Right. But I'm telling you now. So what's this spirit? Spirit of demonic activity. What's the spirit? The spirit of what? Infirmity. Amen? And usually when you have demonic activity, then it comes to a spirit of what? Something bothering you physically. Yes, ma'am?
I was just going to ask you to name the 12 spirits.
It's in my tape series, the 12 spirits. You don't have that yet? The 12 strong men, yeah. Okay, the 12 strong men. If you want, I'll bring some copies for you to get into. Amen. You got to know all the 12 spirits. So now he beholds him. Now everybody circle the word behold, verse number 38. And every time in the Bible there's a behold, guess what happens? What happens when there's a behold? Something phenomenal is going to happen. Amen. A spirit seizes him and he suddenly cries out and convulses him till he foams, shatters him, and he will hardly leave him. Now the spirit, when it enters you, doesn't want to leave. How do you get them in? You do something called stupid. And this is what you do. You go in places you shouldn't be in, and you say things you shouldn't say. Do you know a spirit can come in you by just screaming at the top of your voice at somebody? How many ever seen that happen in your lifetime? You ever seen that? One day I saw a woman with her jugular vein coming out of the neck. How many of that's quite scary? And guess what? If you were to scream at your mother at the top of your lungs, you could invite a spirit of anger inside you. And will it go away? Not necessarily. And guess what? You may not discover it for years. And so you got to go to psychiatrists and you got to take, you got migraines and everything else. Why? Because you might have invited something deep inside of you. So that's why you got to examine yourself. And may I recommend for everyone here, you should do a deliverance. Everybody should go through a deliverance. It doesn't mean you're bad, no, just to be cleansed of the activities that you might have been involved in. Amen? Okay? So
how do you do that?
It convulses him. Now, the convulsion is he doesn't want to leave. When I do a deliverance over people, I say, and they come back for round two or three or four. Then I pray over their stomach and I command it to come out. And when it starts coming out, the person starts convulsing. And sometimes you see their eyes rolling in all different directions. Have you seen all those wonderful things? And then the vomit comes right out. Isn't that great?
Special.
Amen. So when, imagine now, you just saw Jesus transfigured, and you're coming down the mountain, and you see convulsion man. Isn't that great in this kid? Now watch this. Are you getting this? So we get a little hint now. What happened to Elijah and that kid? Back in the book of Kings. We get some kind of a scenario there. He says there, it will hardly leave him. It'll go and then it will come what? Back. Look at verse 40. Now, Jesus' main problem with everybody here. Can I tell you, Jesus got a problem with you? The main problem with everybody that Jesus has in this church, did I say everybody? Did I say everybody? Okay, good. Everybody means what?
Everybody.
Okay, very good. The main problem is that your faith is not exercised. He only corrects you that you didn't use your faith. That's the only correction that God gives you, that you didn't use your faith. Are you using your faith every day? Are you standing up for it? Are you belting it out? Listen to what he says there. Look at this. I beg your disciples to cast it out, but they could not. Why? Now, they went out preaching, and we're going to get in chapter 10 where they're going to go out preaching and casting out devils. But they didn't know how to do this one. Jesus said, oh, faithless! Okay, underline that. And perverse generation. Below, stop right there. We are perverse if we don't use our faith. You thought perverse was just watching a bad movie on television. Or a bad movie in the movies. Perversity is not living your faith the way you should. Now, someone should say, that means something else. If you go with me to Acts 2, go all the way down past 37, 38, 39, 40, 41. Acts chapter 2. Now, there's going to be a line in Acts chapter 2 when Peter is going to baptize 3,000 people, and then he's going to say something like, save yourself, see around verse 42, 142? Save yourself from what? This perverse generation. What's a perverse generation, everybody? You don't believe. Everybody see it there? You see, Luke wrote both Luke and Acts, right? See, he's using the word perverse. So how many would ever think your lack of faith is perverse? I should give you my talk that I just wrote today on those who are not going to make it in the kingdom, and they go to church every Sunday. When push came to the shove, they're not going to stand. They're going to deny Christ. So what's a perverse person? Faithless. And number two, what? They don't believe. So what did Jesus call his generation? What did Peter call his generation right after? You see where Peter got the words from? On the day of Pentecost, I mean, he's not going to make a lot of Pentecostal friends. Save yourself from this wicked and perverse generation. And guess what? We all think everything is okay. You know, with everybody saying there's a lot of problems in the world and things aren't going well, not one of them says we need to repent of our sins and get back to God. Not one says that. Okay, everybody say perverse? Whoa. I hear music in the air. Okay, good stuff. Oh, faithless and perverse generation, how long am I to be with you and bear with you? Now, here's something scary. Jesus doesn't want to be around people with no faith. Look at the line. How am I to be with you? How do you say, I am with you? Emmanuel. All right, now, Here's a scary thought. I told you the scary thought, but you need to be scared right now. If you saw the risen Jesus right now, you'd be the same person you are right now as you were 2,000 years ago. How many just got scared? You mean if I walk with Jesus and I talk with Jesus and I saw him and I heard him give all of his great sermons, I'd still be the same person I am now? How many would like a little life change going on? I mean, you and Jesus go to Red Lobster. You still be the same you? You still say the same things? You still have the same doubts? Are you faithless? And that's why the Lord says, how am I long to be with you? Go to chapter 18, verse 6. This is a line about Middletown, New Jersey. Luke 18, 6. When the Son of Man comes back, will he find what? Did you see it? Did you see it? 18:8? 18:8? I tell you, vindicate speedily, nevertheless, when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith in Middletown? Notice it's the faith again. Now, the moment you die, you don't have to ever believe ever again. The second you die, your faith is gone forever. How many know that? No more faith is required of you. Are you excited about that? Faith is gone.
Faith is only required on earth.
It's all gone. History, baby, history. How long am I to be with you? Bring your son here. Ever see Elijah again? While he was coming, the demon tore him and convulsed him. Why? Because the demon knew that his time was up. And so when the demon caught sight of Jesus, the Son of God, he went, oh! In my office many times, I had people turn over tables, scream at me, forming hands like tigers and lions, faces contorted. And they would often say, when I mention Mary, keep her away from me. So how many know when they're in contact with the holy, they go nuts? Like a Padre Pio, you ever hear Padre Pio?
Yes.
And went absolutely bananas, amen? So what should happen to you when you walk around? Wow, they should go nuts, amen? Do they? And what do? We shake hands with evil. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit. Now, what does rebuke mean? I command you. How many know that you all have the rebuke command? I told you the story that one lady used, she never knew she could do that. She used a rebuke command and her daughter was instantly healed of bipolar. I command you to come out of my daughter, you vile spirit, you bipolar spirit. Come out of her. Now, the first spirit to pray when you're praying over people to get rid of is deaf and dumb spirit. Why? Because that person that you're praying for, you say, well, I prayed and nothing happened. Why? Because maybe there's a deaf, dumb spirit that you're commanding the person to be healed in the name of Jesus, but there's a deaf, dumb spirit on them. So they can't hear a word you said. So the first thing you do is you command the deaf, dumb spirit to come out. Amen? This is how to do a deliverance. But Jesus rebuked the unclean spirit and healed the boy and gave him back to his father. You see Elijah again? He gave him back to his mother. And all were astonished at the majesty of God. People were empowered because they knew when Jesus Christ walked the earth, everything was stirred up with the power of evil. Everything was so stirred up. Did they have demonic activity? Yes. Were the Jews exorcists? Yes. Matthew 13. But did they use it a lot? No, not like this. But when Jesus walked the earth, every turn of the corner that Jesus walked, demon spirits would be screaming everywhere he went. Because they realized that his time was short. That's why when Irma was walking on the Sea of Galilee giving people walking on the sea lessons. I didn't know what she was going to encounter down there. Oh, by the way, when we go to Israel, we're going to be praying on the beach, and we're going to be having candlelight processions right under the Sea of Galilee. Did you have candlelight processions? You went to the wrong group. I told you you went with the wrong group. Now. So we're going to see the power of God. Would you like to? How many know everybody has the power over all evil? But please don't get on a horse tonight and say, I'm going to go knock out the power of evil. No, don't do that. Evil will come to you. Amen?
Amen.
I'm trying to give you primer 101, but you still aren't going to do it. You can call me up and say, it's me to do it. I know your types.
Bring them to front.
And then I'll have a lineup of all Middletown people coming in to get the demons out of your husband. Now, all were astonished at the majesty, because the power of the, what's the awe of the majesty? When God can deliver you from evil. Can I make an observation? When people come to church, they're not delivered from evil. Can I tell you why they leave so unchanged? Because they got the deaf and dumb spirit on them. Can I tell you why they leave early? They're in a fog. And nothing is penetrant. Have you ever seen such people? That's why this one lady always sits up front. Always sits up front. Do you know that lady that always sits up front? Always sits up front. So how many see evil around? I've just encountered it this past week or so again. One day there was a young man that came up to me and he says, hello. I said, well, hello to you. He says, you know who I am? I said, who are you? I am King Thutmose III of Egypt. I said, oh, are you? Yeah, that's who I am. And I rule Egypt. I said, go to Deacon Horny. Go to Deacon Horny. So, and I saw his mother a couple weeks ago, and guess what? He's still in the Trenton psychiatric ward. I'm not an exorcist. I don't have the power of the bishop to do it. There's another woman that called me and says, could you please help my son? I said, I can. I called Father Glenn Sedano up. He's the exorcist, by the way. And I said, I'd be more than happy with you if you want to work on this case with you. But the young man didn't want to come, nor was he desperate. So I can't do anything. So right now he is suffering big time. Amen. And guess what you're going to encounter along your journey. So why were they so astonished? Because they saw the majesty of Jesus putting evil under the feet. Amen? Deliver us from evil. Now what does that mean, deliver us from evil? Remember the Jews always thought in the terms of deliverance, we think of the terms of what? Salvation. Deliver us from the things to come. Don't let me be subject to that. Amen? Good stuff? Does everybody see Elijah? Everybody see the demonic spirits coming? And that's why I get very nervous. Even if you say Harry Potter, I get nervous. I shake with that. Because kids go around with little wands and everything else. Well, that's harmless. No, it's not. But while they were all marveling at this, he said to his disciples, let these words sink into your ears, for the Son of Man is to be delivered into the hands of men. Now, what did we just hear? We just saw the evil that happens. What's the worst evil that could happen? You could be possessed. You could be convulsed. You could be... In another account, he was thrown toward the fire. Do you remember that? The disciples had no power because they didn't know they had power over death and the power over what? Evil. And so what does Jesus say? Now, I got to tell you something. I'm going to be delivered into the hands of men. Now, circle the word men there. That means ungodly men. That means people who don't believe. That means people who don't have faith. That means people even practicing the form of religion but denying power. I'm going to place myself into those hands. And sometimes I feel like I'm in those people's hands every day. And that's why I want to run to you and just start my cave ministry. Right now, I'm going into a cave and they're clearing out all the bats. So that I can have peace, because with their wings, I want no noise at night. Amen? Then he says to us there, let these sink into your ears for the Son of Man. Now, circle the Son of Man. What does Son of Man mean? Suffering servant. This is the suffering servant, the hands of men. But they did not understand the saying. They don't know what Jesus is saying. Do you know what? And I apologize to you. Do you know, most of you say, I don't understand this book. You know why you don't understand this book? Because it's supernatural. These stories really happen, yes? But when you look at them, I don't understand what that means. I wish God would write this all in perfect English. Would we still understand it?
No.
That's why Jesus did something very, very strange. It breaks my heart that he did it. I'm only going to tell most of the world stories. Parables, you might call. But he said, for those of you who really want it, when I tell a story, get out of your pew and come to me and say, what does that mean? So what do you do when you go to church? I have no idea what he said. But you just did your obligation, threw your $5 in the collection. Because you're so cheap anyway, you just gave us $5. Amen? So, what should you have said? I don't understand what those words just meant. Did you ever do that yet? Go up to someone and say, what do these words mean? You didn't do that yet, did you? What if that was the word you needed to hear to get into heaven? And God's going to say to you, Eileen, front and center in the baby. And you have these words on. I didn't know what they were. Nobody told me. How many know that's not going to be your excuse? You got to find out what they mean. So Jesus all of a sudden says, in the midst of all this satanic activity and coming down the mountain, because as soon as he came down at the bottom of Tabor, what's the first thing he says after he heals this demonic spirited kid? What's the first thing he says? I'm going to die. I'm going now. Put a big note there. I'm heading to Jerusalem. And now we're coming to the turning point of the entire Gospel of Luke. The turning point. Where it really, and here now starts the turning point. I'm going to die. You're going to deliver me into despicable people. You've encountered a few of them, haven't you? What we're doing to one another all the time. And then the Lord says, but they did not understand the saying, verse 45, and it was concealed from, it was concealed. Brothers and sisters, can I be honest with you? And I beg your forgiveness again. The gospel has been concealed from you most of your entire life. I was in Mastori's restaurant. Did you ever hear Mastori's restaurant? I like the bread. Yeah, I like Buffalo. And I was sitting there, and there were people from all different denominations. And I gave a talk. And one ex-Catholic comes up to me, and she says, Reverend, because call no man father, so she called me Reverend. Reverend? I said, yes, ma'am. She says, I was once part of your church. I never heard anybody speak like you just did. How come I didn't hear that in my Catholic church? How do I know you have heard the gospel? Because it bothers you. Because what do you say? I'm not living it the way I should. I told you the story. One man runs up to me and says, every time I see you, my stomach turns. I said, oh, doesn't that sound like a soap opera? He says, my suggestion for you is tell us a nice little story. Shut up. And this is the way he says it to me. Shut up and get off. And get us out in 18 minutes. Because when I was explaining gospel truths to him, he could not hear. And that's why those people leave early with the communion in their mouth. That's why right now, you know what we're doing? We're making up our own religion. Every step of the way. This is scary, isn't it? This is very scary. So Jesus now comes and he says that. And then he says there, they're afraid to ask him anything after this. Would you be afraid? And verse 46, we still don't get to the turning point. The turning point, by the way, is verse 51. If you put a big star, the turning point verse is verse 51. The turning point of the whole gospel is verse 51, so you've got to put a big star there. An argument arose among them as which was the greatest. Because why are they talking about the greatest? Because they're leaving Tabor, and what are they doing? They're walking toward Jerusalem. So what do they say? Hey, I think I'm the first. My name is Peter. You pick me first. No, you pick me first. Andrew, you pick me. Remember, Andrew, when you read John chapter 1, I was picked first. No, my mother-in-law. No, I think I'm picked first. No, because I'm the cutest. No, John says I am because I'm the youngest. I'm, you know. Can you hear this discussion? And so what do they do? Word number one. Word number one. Now, who's the greatest in the kingdom of God? Matthew 5 says, the teacher in our midst. The person who teaches, you're the greatest. Amen? Do you like teaching? Well, you have. You have an interesting daughter. You put it down in the basement. I mean, you have interesting people. Amen? How many of everybody here has taught somebody something? Everybody shake your head, yes. An argument arose among them, verse 46, which was the greatest. And when Jesus perceived the thought of their hearts, by the way, put in there, underline that there, verse number 47. Jesus reads hearts. Somebody just said to me last week, do you read hearts? Mm-hmm. Yeah, that means I can tell you what's going on. If you reveal to me your thoughts, I'll tell you what's going on inside you. In fact, when I was having a word of knowledge over a group of teenagers, there's about 10 of them right at St. Mary's in Mater Dei School. We're doing a little retreat with church. I went up to 8 of them and I told them exactly about their life. I said, how did you do that? And then, of course, they said, do me, do me. And then I said, send that to 9. And I did another group of women. I never met them before. How did you do that? That's exactly true about my life. Whoa. How many know that could scare you? Amen? They proceeded. Now, so everybody put in there, reading hearts. He took a child and put him by his side. Now, by the way, there is a belief, just for your FYI. Who is that child, FYI? How many ever heard of the book in the Bible called Philemon? Never heard of the book? Are you sure she's your sister? Could you please get her a Bible? Ma'am. There's a book called Philemon, or some say Philemon, some say tomato, and some say tomato, some say potato, and some say potato. Now Philemon was a slave owner, and he had a slave called Onesimus. And the word Onesimus means useful. It's believed that was the child right there. Onesimus was the child. That's just a Christian tradition. Oh, amen? So Jesus takes Onesimus, if that be the case. Now, if you circle the word child there, the word child is a 3 to 4 year older. When he says 3 or 4 year older, here's what he means. A 3 or 4 year old is, don't worry about the bills being paid, have you noticed? Find a 3 or 4 year old. I have 2 great nephews and 1's in the oven. If I ask them, are you worried about the bills? I don't think so. If I said to them, you know what, Brandon, the moon is made of green cheese. Okay, Uncle Bill. They believe everything we said. That's why when you were an interesting parent, were you interesting parents when your kids were 3 and 4? Who did they go to thinking that you knew everything there was about God? Right? And remember the answers you used to give them? Oh, Lord, save us, the answers you gave them. Do you remember the answers you gave them? Remember when Melissa asked you all those questions? Now look at her. Look at her now. Amen? Amen? So that's a 3 or 4 year old. Are you getting, how many want to be a child now? Whoever receives this child, now, underline the word receive. What do you got to do, brothers and sisters? Receive is taking them in. Taking them in is another reference to the Holy Spirit. You got to receive little children. Amen? How many love kids? Do you all love kids? Receive. Galatians chapter 3, you got to receive. Did you receive the Holy Spirit or did you receive in vain? What did we say when we go to communion years ago? Did you receive? So receive here. Whoever receives, look with me in verse number 47. 48. Whoever receives in my name, now you got to receive in the name of Jesus. Name means the mission. receives me. If you receive a child, you receive Jesus. That's why every week I gotta go work with them. They say sometimes the most wildest things to me. I got scared because the last question I remember very vividly is, if there's male and female and the other thing in heaven, who are they gonna be? I'm like, go ask your mother. How many know I gave a good answer, amen? Okay, whoever receives, now watch what Jesus says there, beloved, receives. Look at verse number 48. Whoever receives me receives him who sent me. So if I receive a child, see the Holy Spirit, I receive Jesus. And if I receive Jesus, I receive the Father. And you can do the happy dance. The reception goes on and on. Now, let me give you an image. It's the reception line after you got married. Anybody ever get married before? Anybody ever heard of marriage? You know, after, and off they go. And then there's a line at the back of church. Congratulations. Good luck, you'll need it. I mean, all that stuff, I remember. So if you receive them, if I receive the children, who do? I receive the parents. If I receive the parents, I receive the grandparents. You see the line that I receive? Just by saying to them. You know, it's amazing. The other day when we were burying my mother, I just did a wedding last Sunday. Two Sundays. She came. She said, Father, I heard your mom died. And the next day she's going on her honeymoon with her beloved. But she came to the funeral mass. She says, I want to come to honor you. So I turned around and she was there. The bride was at the funeral mass. So I received her, she received me. And by the way, when you receive me, you receive my mother, you receive my father. Yes. You see this power of receiving? And it begins by, what does it mean? By taking a small person and receiving them because of their faith and their belief. How many think we could do that? What would happen if we had a church like that?
Acceptance.
You've got it. Excellent. Excellent analogy. That is acceptance. Good for you. Excellent. And whoever, for he who is least among you is one is the great. Now, everybody here thinks you love God, right? On a good day, you love God. Trust me. You love God always. All right, let's see if you love God. She's got to take off her glasses now. Do you love God, Miss Jackie?
Yes.
All right, now, let's see who loves God here. Ready? Turn to the person and say, get ready for this.
Get ready for this.
Now, everybody here says they love God, yes?
Yes.
You love God according to the person you would like to be the least around. You don't love God? So how many love God now? You still gonna raise your hand? Don't get nervous, I won't correct you. See where the child comes in? If this be the Onesimus of Philemon, that little page in the Bible, he was so rejected. And what is Paul saying to Philemon? Receive him. Because when you receive Philemon, when you receive Onesimus, you receive me. When you receive me, you receive him who sent me. Now watch this. This is really powerful. Everybody here has probably been rejected by somebody in your life at least once, right? When they reject you, they reject Christ. And all my problems in the world is one word, Christ. All my joys in the world is one word, Christ. So guess what? If they receive me, you receive my mother. If you receive my mother, you receive my family. You see how it goes on now? It goes all the way up into your personal encounter with God. How many like would like to do some more receiving? So that's why it's so good to be with the little kids. It's so good. I love when they come up to me, I'm preaching a conference, and they say, hey, I say, yeah? That's the way they talk to me. Hey, you. I say, yeah. I say, how about you? You? And they said, you know what? I said, what? You're funny. I said, you're getting good stuff. I was doing the wedding a week or so ago, and I was telling the bride and the groom about the interesting exploits of marriage. And a little girl in the front row started laughing, and she shook the whole church. You know, when someone laughs, and all of a sudden everybody starts laughing, when she starts laughing, she couldn't stop laughing. I said, listen to her. She's got some wisdom, that little kid. So how many would like to, the next time you're on a reception line, that's what you're doing. That's what you're doing. When I do weddings, I always go up to both parents, congratulate them, hug them. I thank them both publicly and personally. I go to the groom and to the bride, and then go everybody up and down because I want to be received. And when I do that, it's a great act of the Holy Spirit. Now, with all of that in mind, ready for this? That's how to become, look what Jesus said there. That's how to become the greatest. John answered verse 49. Is this good stuff?
Yes.
Master, we saw, remember, how do you say master in Greek? Let me write it on the board. Despotes, D-E-S-P-O-T-E-S. Despotes, D-E-S-P-O-T-E-S. Master, we saw a man casting out demons in your name. So, do you know there are people going around saying, now, how many know Jews have exorcisms? You never hear that, do you? When you talk to Orthodox Jews, they mention exorcisms. So, how many know they have exorcisms? It goes all the way back to the time of the, don't tell me, go ahead, tell me, Exodus 3. It's called, when the Ten Commandments are written, it's called the what? The finger of God. I cast them out by the finger of God. So what's the finger of God in Judaism? The Ten Commandments. Remember, we just learned if you're not a faith-filled person, you're what? You're perverse. That's a strong word, isn't it? Now, with the finger of God is the power of God to cast out. How many know you all have the finger of God on you? Because you are mighty men and women of God, obedient to the word of God. Amen? So all of a sudden he says, John, hey, master, despotes. We just saw somebody using your name. And you know what he was saying? In the name of Jesus. Well, this is scary. The Shem. In the name of the Shem, S-H-E-M. In the name of the Shem, the very mission, the very person of Jesus, I cast you out. Whoa, and guess what happened? The demon went flying. So guess what? There was somebody in the crowd that heard Jesus preach. They didn't follow the rest of us disciples, and they said, I got this down. They were taking notes. They took their CD. They heard it on their DVDs, on their me pads, moo pads, my pads. They heard it over again. They played it on their flat TV screen. I said, now I know how to do it. And they went about saying, in the name of Jesus, come out. And all of a sudden, what happened? The devil started leaving. This is a rare case story, isn't it? And we forbade him, stop doing that. You don't know who we are. You're not part of our company. How many know we get mad? Can I tell you how we get mad? Right across the street, there's a Pentecostal church. And they look like they know what they're doing. Kath fell asleep at my preaching. They're bouncing around over there. And all of a sudden, they're casting out devils over there. And it looks like my people just invited the devil into them, and they're going out, come on, come on, come on. I look across the street and I said, I wish my people were like them. And then this one lady, I know she watches Joyce Meyer. And she gets like 10, 20,000 people. And I said, why can't we pack our stadiums? Amen? Why can't we bring them in? What if this one lady got to watch Joyce Myers every morning trying to feed the door a $327 pill? I don't get it. And so there's a part of me that looks over and says, should I go over across the street and tell them to stop? Amen. Should I go and tell them to stop? No. What did John try to do? Stop! In the name of love.
Yes,
are you getting this, Miss Jackie?
Yes, sir.
She's looking at me, Miss Jackie. And Jesus said to him, don't forbid him. For he that is not against you is for you. By the way, Paul uses that too in Romans chapter 8, verse 32. If God is for you, who can be
against you?
If God is for us, who can be against? Amen?
Amen.
Emmanuel. I hope you heard me in the third pew there. Emmanuel. God's for me. Who can possibly be against? Who can be against us? Are you getting this? Is this good? Now, do not forbid him, he is not with you. Now, finally, let's begin to wrap up here. Good stuff.
Good stuff.
This now is the height of the gospel. We just went from Luke 1 all the way up to 9:51. We just hit the top of the summit. Wait a minute, you said the top of the summit was Transfiguration. The top of the summit is Calvary. Because what's going to happen to that mountain, it has to first yield to Calvary. So now we come to the turning point of the entire Bible. And you got to put triple stars there. This is the turning point. When the days drew near for him to be received up to... Oh, what word do we have again? Receive. Somebody say, Now, who got received up? Elijah. Tomorrow's reading. 2 Kings chapter 1, 2 Kings chapter 2. He's received up. What happened to Jesus on the ascension? Received up. When Jesus was ascended, what did he do? He dropped the mantle on us of Elijah. Allah. What's the mantle of Elijah that you all have? It's for miracles. But guess how many miracles you used in your life? None. You want me to do it? Forget about it. You do it. Amen. Well, you better keep coming.
Amen.
I got to do a day of healing. I got to teach you how to pray in biblically. Because your prayer life is woeful. You know when I have healing masses? I have somebody come up to me all the time for 23 years. Hi, what am I praying for? Here, touch it right there. I said, what? What do you want me to touch? I don't touch women. Do you see what I got to say? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. I pray for the Muslim family over there.
Great.
And I use Jesus' name.
Great. To Jerusalem. Okay, now, this is really good. Turn to the person next to you. This is really good.
This is really good.
This is real.
He set his face now. If you underline there, set your face. Set your face means you're going to get it smacked.
Okay.
Set your face means lock it in. How many ever locked your face in? Set your face. Right? Every time I set my face, here's my prayer. Lord, go before me, and may I find favor in your sight. So underline that, this is the turning point of the entire gospel. He set his face toward Jerusalem. What does it mean? I'm going to meet nothing but opposition. Everybody see that? All right, let's now see the opposition. And he sent his messengers ahead of him. How many know Jesus sent messengers ahead of him? Who went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him. Okay, now, those who go with me to Israel, they never do this on tours. I'm taking a Samaritan. You're going to see where the Samaritan, they never do this. Never, never, I'm taking you to Samaria. And when you go to Samaria, we're going to go to the well, and then you're going to see the waterfalls and the mountain ranges where the tribes of Israel gather. Okay, you're going to see brand new stuff. Now, what happens is this. Go to Samaria, but there's a problem. I'm a pure Jew, and the Samaritans aren't pure Jews. So two or seven, the Messiah is coming, Jesus is coming. Guess what the Samaritans did? Where were they liked? That's why we have, during Lent, the Samaritan woman story. When did it happen? Right now. So you could put a little, by the way, in there, John 4. What was the Samaritan's woman name? Fotina. I did a big study on all of Fotina. Okay? That was her name, Fotina. Interesting. Somebody said, And entered a village of the Samaritans to make ready for him, but the people would not receive. Do you keep hearing that word receive? By the way, the Greek word for receive is, I'll spell it for you, lambano. It sounds like the Lombardi is, you know? L-A-M-B-A-N-O, lambano. L-A-M-B-A-N-O, lambano. They didn't receive, they didn't lambano him. They didn't take him in. So when the, remember now, Jesus walking, we just done with Mount Tabor. He said, I'm going into the hands of evil men. They hit Samaria because when you go to Jerusalem, there's a mountain range. I'm taking them to that mountain range. And everyone's going to meet Shushu and drive on camels and everything else. So yeah, I got a better story. And then what happens then is they said, don't come here. Why? Because Jesus is from, they believe and understand, Jerusalem. And then who goes in town to get them? One last time, Jesus does. What's the first preaching of the gospel ever? It's to the Samaritans, Acts 8. Because in order for Jesus to save the world, he has to first save Jerusalem. What happened in Jerusalem? Pentecost. Do you remember Pentecost? What's the second thing that happened? He's got to save the Samaritans. Where was the first Holy Spirit revival ever recorded in sacred scripture? Acts 8 with Philip. And then Philip got an interesting ride. Remember, he was translated. That means he was lifted from here to here. He did Star Trek movie. Amen? And by the way, when you go to heaven one day, you'll be in one spot. Oh, let's go see Clara. Okay. You'll be there instantly. How many know you'll be there instantly? Called translation. You're going to be translated in all parts of glory. So when it's your time to die, would you do me a favor and die and go? Do you want to come back here? No. Forget about it. Amen? Are you getting this down? Forget about it. Amen? And because he said his face was toward Jerusalem, that's why they didn't receive Jesus, because Jesus is coming. He's going to Jerusalem. He can't come in here. But he did come in there, and then you can put in there John 4 to Fotina. So he did get them. Remember? Verse 56. And when the disciples, James and John, saw it, they said, Lord, do you want us to call down fire? Yes. Let's go bowling. I got an idea. Send down fire. Cook them, cook them, cook them, cook them. Let them have it. Let them have it. Amen? This remembers. Because Elijah in 1 Kings 18 had to face the 450 prophets of Baal and another 400. And what did they do? There was a fire test. And what happened is they killed a couple animals. They put it on an altar and they dunked three times and doused it in water. And God says there's going to be fire. And so what did they do? The 850 prophets went like this. Hey, 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 cut, slash, cut, slash, slash, cut, 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 cut your face. Hey, 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 cut, cut, cut. And a sudden, Elijah says, excuse me, is your God meditating? And that means in 1831 of Kings, is he on the job? That's what it means in Hebrew. And how many know you're not going to pick that up in your English Bible? Amen? They were sitting on the John waiting for their deity to come and save them. Amen? That's what it means literally. You're looking like I'm making this up. How many know you're getting good stuff? Is your God sitting on the John? Amen? How many know you're learning good stuff tonight? Amen? And what happened? All of a sudden, they were done praying their 6 hours and nothing happened. Elijah says, oh Lord, show him your God. Fire came down. And by the way, where was that happening? Not too far away from Samaria, Mount Carmel. Have you ever heard of Our Lady of Mount Carmel? Now here's something that you don't know about Our Lady of Mount Carmel. Our Lady of Mount Carmel is a warrior, Blessed Mother. Did you know that? You ever ask the intercession of Our Lady of Mount Carmel? Amen? Do you do that? That's Our Lady of Mount Carmel. Amen? I hope you know all these things. Do you know all these things? So, come down from heaven and consume them. Because that happened in the book of Kings, chapter 18. But he turned and rebuked them. No, Jesus says, no, I don't do that. That's not how it operates. And they went on to another village. So guess who wasn't included in being saved or whatever, except that woman, Fudina. And then started going on the road. Where are we going, everybody? Jerusalem, Jerusalem. A man said to him, I will follow you wherever you go. And by the way, everybody gets all caught up at the moment. This is called the parable of the seeds. Oh, let's go, let's go. Let's do it. How many have ever been to a Christian concert, a Christian gathering, the young people, everybody got all juiced up for the day, and then the next day came and they're back to worse than normal. Have you ever seen that happen? Jesus said, and foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. That's why there was no room for him in the inn. We only found one place for Jesus. Go to the cross. That is it. Amen? And then he said to them, verse 59, to another he said, follow me. And what does follow mean in Greek? It literally means get on my coattails. How many ever taken a child and you walked with them and they were on your feet? We all did that. And they clung to your legs. But he said to him, Lord, let me first go and bury my father now. And Jesus said, Marty, let the dead bury their own dead. What does this mean? The immediacy of the gospel is now. Wait. Let me wait till my father dies. Then I'll come follow you. The immediacy of following Jesus is now. So Jesus says, the dead will take care of the dead. You come and follow me. Well, what does it mean? The dead man goes around with his own shovel. He'll be taken care of. Amen? And back then, they wrapped you in a sheet, not in a coffin, and they waked you in the house for a few days. So what happens is, wrap him up and let the wrapping, somebody will wrap him. The dead will bury the dead. Follow me. Follow me.
When you say the dead means the faithless.
No, no, no. Here's not the faithless. No. He was making an excuse saying, I'll follow you, but I got this obligation, this family obligation. And it's because somebody's home and I got to take care of them. And so it's my father and I'll wait till he dies and then I'll look you up. And our Lord says, in the Hebrewism, let the dead take care of the dead. In other words, you are entering into waiting for death, and then by the time you wait for the dead, your faith in me will be dead. So let the dead bury the dead. Yes. Now, I'm just having cases, and a deacon could say the same thing. I'm told when I go to certain places, no prayers. Save the deceased. Because every Jew would have a letter. Kudashim. Everybody knows. Let me write that word. K-I-D-D-U-S-H-I-M. K-I-D-D-U-S-H-I-M. Kedushim. That's praying for the dead. Jesus never said, don't pray for the dead. By the way, just for your information, there is one small verse in the Bible, and you're the only ones in Middletown that know this, that says you're supposed to pray for the dead in the New Testament. Did you know that? 2 Timothy chapter 1, they mention praying for the dead. You're the only ones on your block that know that. 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right there. Maccabees. That's another whole topic. So now, everybody understand what it means, let the dead bury the dead? You're waiting for your father to be dead. But if you don't follow me now, you're dead. So then, if you wait for your father to die, he's dead and you're dead, so let the dead, and then you're the dead one because you didn't have me, so let the dead bury the dead. How many think you got it? You got it. Isn't that a great verse? Every time I saw Deacon Martin, I said, Deacon, let the dead bury the dead. And we had some real Lulus up there. Lulu. By the way, in my archdiocese, they don't allow you to get up and give a little ditty about people. Yes. Move along. Amen. Amen. You're not saying amen. Does everybody understand let the dead bury the dead? It's powerful, isn't it? Okay, let the dead bury the dead. But you, my dear, you're filled with life. So you're a woman of life, bury the dead. And so because in the person you buried, there's been a lot of good life. Are you getting this? You gotta get this. I'm giving you good stuff. And we're almost done. But he said to him, leave the dead to bury their own dead, but as far as you, go and proclaim a kingdom. Now, see the word go. And the word go means as you are moving. You know what I did today? I had a lot of fun. I sat down where I was. I was back in Galantis, where my mother was buried at. And I sat down and said, I need to talk to you about Jesus. He said, look, Father, I've been in church so many days during the week. So I don't need to go on Sunday. So I smacked him and put him in a coffin and everything else on Thursday, I'm doing his funeral. And then his mother said, oh, isn't it true that at a certain age, you don't have to go anymore? I said, where are they getting old? And then I stood up, let the dead bury the dead, I'm out of here, and I'm shaking the dust off my feet of this place here and see if I ever come back to Galantis for the rest of my life. Forget about it! I got scared. Next he says there, verse number 40, proclaim the kingdom. Remember, in Luke's gospel, we are kingdom people, amen? And finally, never thought we'd get there. I will follow you, Lord. And one says, but let me first say farewell to those at home. No! You can't go home and say, doodles, goodbye. See you, wouldn't want to be here. No. You can't even say goodbye. Because the urgency of the kingdom is the move now. Because where's Jesus going? Jesus. And what happens if you went home and say, how many ever had to do something at the last minute and you missed the rest of the group moving out? This group is inviting everybody to come along, to walk with you to Jerusalem. But if you go back and say goodbye to everybody, you're going to miss the rest of the group. What does that sound like? Matthew 25. Can I have some of your oil? And by the way, a lot of Catholics are foolish. Amen? Everybody here right now, you should have enough oil to get to heaven. Then he says there, Jesus said to him, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom. We got to go get news. We got the seeds of the kingdom. We can't look back. We just got to keep going forward. Because this is a new day. Since the Lord took my mother last Tuesday night at 7, the Lord's impressed upon me right now in my life. It's a new day for me. Mom, intercede! I just got to keep going forward now in the kingdom of God with the same purpose that I always grew up believing. I got to get the gospel out for one more person, that the world will be saved. You know, Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And I can't go back. Don't go back. Now, you're not allowed to beat yourself up. You're not allowed to feel sorry that you didn't do enough. Amen? Anybody ever been there? I didn't do enough. That's every one of us. Ask the person next to you, did you ever do that? Shake your head, yes. Did you ever feel sorry for yourself? Every time you feel sorry for yourself, you grieve the Holy Spirit. You are mighty men and women of God, so you got to keep the plow. We keep moving. All right. My mom's gone home, okay? Sadly, she taught me, don't cry. I cried by just freezing for a moment and looking out. I got to move on now. I put an ad in the paper, Mom Wanted. So I got to keep going now. I got to go proclaim the kingdom of God. This is what I've been called to do, to get one more person into the kingdom of God. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. This is what I've been called to do. And above all, here's your lesson. No more excuses. Don't excuse that, wait until my father's dead. Wait until I say goodbye. What's the third one there? I gotta go home and say goodbye to everybody. I gotta wait until. And notice one thing there. What's really scary? It's all family. Now, what's the number one thing you say to me while you want to be healed? The number one you mother say. The number one thing you say for my family. Wrong. You never mention God to me. Why do I want to be healed? To glorify God.
Amen.
Now, Lord willing, next week you'll be at the. We're going to continue power evangelism like you've never heard it before, and you'll miss Poppy as we're going to another. So you're going to be missing some good stuff. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Good stuff.
Now we have these young people that I met. What are everybody's names?
Like.
None. Welcome them. Our job is to bring 10 people each. Our job is to get 100 people here. Who's this young lady again? Your sister.
Catherine.
Miss Catherine, it's good. You were here before, right?
Yes.
I know. I saw your good-looking countenance before. Okay. Amen. Thank you for your well wishes from my mother's. And thank you for coming to the funeral, to the funeral mass. By the way, they said they've never seen a funeral mass ever like that, ever, in the history of that church. Amen.
Amen.
And by the way, even the people in the church and the people in the funeral parlor are still talking about it.
Amen.
And especially when you sing, how great thou art, how great thou art. Wasn't that glorious?
Yes.
And they sang Latin to my mother and everything else. 15 priests come celebrating. It was magnificent.
Way to
what a send-off. Amen.
Amen.
Good stuff.
Good stuff.
Good stuff. Okay.
Thank you.
I hope that next week we'll continue. Don't miss it, ma'am. We're going to do the absolute center of power evangelism. And you don't want to miss an episode next week. Not one little episode of power evangelism. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord speak to you, Miss Ling of Ling. Father, we just ask you to bless us, and we just ask that your mighty name be proclaimed. And Father, forgive us for all the times we make excuses, feel sorry for ourselves. Lift us up, Lord, to be your mighty men and women. And Lord, we proclaim the truth of the gospel, that Jesus Christ is the way, truth, and life. Amen and amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Don't feel sorry for yourself. See, I'm just coming off of a death. So there, I have personal witness.